Okay, welcome everybody. So the first talk is hopefully going to provide some context to what today is all about and how we can progress both research and practice concurrently. So we're going to talk about the research that we do, the forces behind it, and how Andy, as a coach, for example, used it. Now, our experience of working with coaches and academics is brilliant because it provides a real life challenge. And Andy's the best example of that because his face doesn't lie when he's disappointed. The amount of times we share his work with him and the look of, it's not going to work. Now, that's a brilliant piece for an academic to actually then realise, okay, well, maybe we need to change it somewhere along the line. Maybe our interpretation of what's needed isn't the same as what the coach is needed. And that's hopefully the philosophy of today, so that was something that was some findings for everybody to take away and hopefully develop practice. So, when we look at this understanding research and practice, it's something that's commonly discussed, a common challenge that people acknowledge, that the reality is they're both not the same thing, they're completely different. And research in terms of what drives us as academics from an institution to do research is about developing new knowledge. And the development of new knowledge is fantastic because at some point it does transfer through and it does help people. But at times that may be slow, and at times that may be at the pitch at the wrong level or the wrong context, or actually what coach may want or may need. And then if we look at practice, people within practice strive to develop and adopt best practice. They want to use research and new knowledge in their practice and in their day-to-day working life. But the reality is, if we look at how practice and how coaching is set up, perhaps also that system's not quite adopted, set up for actually this slow-burning trickle of knowledge. So actually, our main philosophy is, how can we develop research and practice concurrently to benefit both? Because actually, if we have this joined approach, then surely both of these areas will benefit and both of these areas will develop. So, by accepting the challenges on both sides of the coin, I think that positions us really well to actually help implement research into practice and also help implement practice back into research as well, provide feedback back to what didn't work. Now, I think we've all got to acknowledge that that both of these different parties have unique challenges. And if we look at that from a kind of a higher level, I think that the best example of that is almost if you treat the practice, the day-to-day, as a working fast group, and the academic, the research side, as a working slow group. And the best example you can use for that, if somebody is working in practice, and they want to look at the fatigue status of an athlete, they don't have weeks, months, to work out whether it was real or not. They literally have minutes. They have minutes to work out whether that decrease in jump was relevant to actually take athlete out of training, to quantify training. Where we as academics, we can look at that data, we can scrutinise that data, we can go back and get more data, we can run various different tests. So, if we can create partnerships whereby the academic arm, which is the working slow arm, works with the practical arm, which is the working fast arm, and actually not only keeps two distinct different groups, but actually create an overlap, that then creates a perfect opportunity and synergy to use research in practice. And also to help progress the research by providing some challenge, some actual real life challenges back into the research. And that's again the philosophy of how the project's evolved. Now, we've also got to acknowledge as well that within research, the development of new knowledge is fantastic, but it's also complicated. So if we look at almost this two polarised system where you've got one strand which is trying to develop as much knowledge as they can versus a group which is trying to implement things as fast as they can, there's a danger that you get a polarised view. And actually, the example of that is that as researchers we provide tools, but if we don't as research provide people with the skills to use those tools, or even the education and the familiarity with those tools, they won't ever work. And then we should be then as researchers helping facilitate and integrate that process back into practice. Because otherwise, we end up with loads of tools that nobody really knows how to use. And then again, in terms of trying to create a joinable philosophy, I'm not sure that will achieve that. So if we work almost back to why, some of the potential challenges, and we can share those, and we can share some of the solutions that we found as a group to almost overcome those. And I think the most high-level version of that is looking at, in theory and practice are the same, because why wouldn't it be? But in practice they're not. They're so very different. But we need to acknowledge where each party can then support the other. And again, the example of that is looking at not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted. So as sports scientists, just because we can measure it, doesn't mean that they want us to measure it, or that it follows through to what the coach believes is their journey they're going on. But then we've got to also look at the flip of that, is our role as scientists is to genuinely provide objective insights and objective data to help the decision-making process. So without data, we're genuinely sat there with an opinion. So if we have these two lenses on as we're viewing research, it provides a nice balanced view in terms of making sure that things we're counting do count, but actually making sure that where we think that we can't measure something at the moment, we need to look at ways in which we can do that to help provide objective data to support the decision-making process. And from our experience, and I think other academics in the room will appreciate this, I think you could probably boil down the challenges of research and practice down to three fundamental things. Resource, because as an academic, the research that we do, someone needs to pay for it. Communication and time. So if we look at those three things, if we can find a way to actually align those three things with what the practitioner needs, the end user needs, we provide a solution to the actual probably the three main challenges that exist in research, and this is the applied research where we're trying to implement some knowledge within practice. And the analogy that I like to use a lot is kind of good cheap fast, you know, we have two of them. And if we all appreciate that, it kind of provides a bit of a rules and state of play, that we can have stuff that are good and cheap, it won't be fast. And then likewise, if we have things that are cheap and fast, it won't be good. But I'll just spend some time in terms of looking at what good is. Because I think if you look at it from an academic point of view, our reference point of what good may be different to what practitioner may think good is. So good for us isn't always developing the most complex knowledge. Good may be developing the most applicable knowledge to transfer into the game. So again, working with your practitioner, if you're an academic, or equally if you're a practitioner working with an academic, you can define good at the start. What does good mean? What do you want it to look like at the end? And then we can then work back through, okay, how do we get to that point? And again, so for the academics in the room, this is very simple, but I think it provides, for the practitioner who may be not as familiar with the research process, it provides an example of what the research process is. And I think at times there's a lack of understanding or appreciation of what that model looks like in terms of how long it takes to generate knowledge. And if we use knowledge as the paper published and you can go find and read it, then it's a slow process. So we need to find ways in which we can speed that process up to feed back information knowledge back into the game quickly. So the nine steps in which that we defined or we identified research as was, the first one was developing the research question. After that, you gain ethics approval, you then recruit voluntary participants, we then collect data, we analyse data, we write the research paper, we submit the manuscript for peer review publication, we hope that it gets published. At that point, knowledge is created. And then this kind of final step is actually, we should then look at how those findings can be used in practice. And I think that final step, that step nine, is something that historically and traditionally hasn't existed in academia. And that's something that we've been really passionate about trying to integrate. Because, and this isn't saying that all research should be applied, because it shouldn't. But if this process, instead of being a 9-step process, an 8-step process, and from step 8, it goes back into defining the research question, then what happens if we have our research question wrong? And what we identified is almost four stages where this can go wrong, and the four challenges which are fundamental to make it work. The first one is create a research question. If you get that wrong as an academic or a researcher, there's not a chance you're going to be able to improve participants. Because people don't loan their high-value, high-quality participants to research questions they're interested in. So straight away, fundamentally, question one, you have to make sure the research question's right. Then we get buy-in because we both want to know the answer, therefore we can use the participants together in terms of the players in the cohort. We've also then got to acknowledge that within practice, in majority of cases, steps 4 to 7, they're not really a priority for practice. Because once someone's been led in their participants, they will know the answers. So we've then got to make sure that when we say knowledge is crazy, it actually is, and it's not crazy in terms of publication that potentially nobody reads or nobody can get access to, or that is eventually published 18 months after the study was originally conceived and completed. So, and then we also look at step 9. And as an example, it's an example of where this potentially can go wrong. So it's probably three areas in sports science that you can use to challenge these notes and show where it hasn't worked. The first one is around hydration. So if anybody has ever googled hydration, you will find a lot of papers. And what we kind of did, what hydration did as an academic discipline, is they showed how dehydration affected performance, which was great and it was right. But actually what they didn't show was that athletes weren't dehydrated before they showed that. Then what happened is, athletes then became scared of dehydration, drank lots of water, so now researchers spend time so to drink less water than they were doing before we saw the problem with dehydration and affected performance. Make sense? So, and another one around supplements, we did a phenomenal amount of work on energetic aging in their practices, and there's now a great body of work looking at why whole foods are better than supplements because it's not misdoing. And equally, this is the example of how we can use different recovery strategies to allow athletes to recover quicker, and now they're spending a lot of time in practice, so people stop using recovery strategies because you may be attenuating adaptation. So we've got to make sure that actually the research question that we ask and answer is what people want and is fed back at an appropriate level. So if we ensure both the researcher and the practitioner agree on the question at the start, if both think it's relevant, then we get high-level participants. We get the elite athletes that we want. We don't have to recruit some elite. We get the people in the physiology that's representative of those that we're trying to develop and try to improve. If we agree on method of dissemination outside of peer review publication, that then feeds back into the next research question, because we're then generating knowledge in practice as well as generating knowledge in research and academia. And if we as researchers and practitioners can't integrate our own research into practice, we can't expect anybody else to. So we need to look at what our question was. Does a development need in the question, the way that we collect the data, or the way that we analyse and interpret the data? Because without those four steps, I think that we'll struggle to see the progressive cycle of applied research development practice. So we often talk about how to bridge the gap between research and practice. And again, going back to what I started off saying, they are different, they're not the same thing. Academics aren't employed to do practice, and practitioners aren't employed to do research. So one of our philosophies is almost creating this bridging gap, and this research practitioner who, for us, provides this great insight of and some context of sequences that occur within certain organisations, things that won't, things that will work. And actually, if you create between a research and a practice group, this almost research practice in the middle, I think the research has a lot more opportunities to stick in terms of translation both back into research and also into practice.
Hi all. I'm going to try and just wrap up what Ben's discussed there and very much try and talk about some of the mechanisms that might work from a coach's perspective on not just integrating research and practice, but actually, Ben's made mention there almost two polarized views. And I think if you look at those two different worlds, because oftentimes they are, call that the appropriate coaching and within academia, within university questions, the world that goes on here is very different from the world that goes on the grass on the ground in the professional sports world. It doesn't mean we can't have a problem with each other.
And some of the things that Ben was mentioning, I will turn around a lot for Ben's most work here, which is that academia and coaching behind. So I don't really know what's behind me a great deal. But some of the things which are really important to understand is whenever we start to try and improve practice, we start with something. So if that's A, and we're trying to get it to B, we start with something in front of us that we want to try and improve. And the reality is, however far we improve that, and Ben's going to discuss this again later on, but however far we improve that, and we've gone from A to D, it's still got to then work in the context in which we then deliver, the context in which we then try to improve what we do with our players, participants, athletes. And this is very much about understanding the world that we're then putting that knowledge into. So we can take something in and move it to B, whether that's knowledge, whether that's practice, whether it's coaching, whether it's published research, we can add value to it every day. We've still got to work in the world that we live in. So this really fast hour, which has been improved drastically from the first one that you saw, they've still got to work on this dirt track. And just flipping back slightly, I think as we think about things here again, these two worlds are really important. And I think as a coach, it's really easy to just live in your world and consider the knowledge that you need is something which gives you as much knowledge as you can now to change performance tomorrow. Or I'm working with this player, and he's the most important thing that I, the most important person I can influence that he has developed his career or a progression as a new captain. And it's really important to get knowledge that's important now for him, but it's also important that I also understand that there's another world here which doesn't have to be fed by knowledge which can change his tomorrow. It can be fed by knowledge and understanding and application of theory which can change the world that I operate in 2 years. So I mean, there's a certain acceptance that we do live in slightly different worlds, and actually we can both get great advantages from either seeing more side of the fence or acquiring knowledge and understanding which can change what I do tomorrow, but can also maybe change what I do in 2 years. So if I'm a youth sports coach who's working with 16-year-olds or under 16 players, I've only ever advanced my knowledge and then I've still got practice so much in any single week, month or year. It doesn't mean that every single piece of research or joint venture research is going on between academia and the sports world is only relevant if that's it, isn't it? Because I'm still going to be working with 16-year-olds in 3 years' time and I don't want to be a better coach then than I am now. So I think that acceptance of the different ways in which to conduct research, there's also different speed at which knowledge is created. And I think if we skip along this road, there's certain things which allow us to improve from here to here quite quickly. Certain things which allow us to improve from here to here quite slowly. Maybe very slowly in that case. But this context is always changing, and as a coach, it will always change. I think this working fast, working slow sort of two worlds, I'm not going to call it dichotomy, it's not two very different universes which then interact. They need to interact, but as a coach, and certainly as a coach in a professional sports club with youth athletes, my job's very different to my boss, the guy I work with every day who's working with our first team. It's very different to the school teachers that I'm working with who also work with some of our 16-year-olds. It's also very different to the club coach who sees them on Sunday morning. So however much knowledge that we actually create, even and practice that we develop as a coach, it's still got to be translatable to both different environments, even for any one single player. I think that some of the things which we're going to continue to talk about today, and certainly some of the presentations, hopefully, can really simplify some of the things which get done in research and give some perspective on how we can generate knowledge which is useful to us. We're all different because all our players and all our contexts are.
I'll let you jump in on this one.
We're just going to talk very quickly about how some of the ways in which new knowledge can be generated and used, and then we're going to talk again very quickly before we wrap up on Ben mentioned the research practitioner roles, and they're really important for me that I've been incredibly lucky to work with a number of guys in the room today who very much what we talk about span that divide and sit on that bridge between the two worlds. And even from a purely selfish and coaching point of view, probably some of the best development I have been exposed to working with people who understand both ways. Because when you just operate one every day, you get a very limited, a very limited view on the things that you should be looking at and the things that are important. So Ben will get us there and we'll do a little bit more on how that looks in practice, how it looks for the course, but also for the research practice.
I may have to announce it as well. So, I think from our point of view as a researcher, working with a coach, and it's all about sharing the journey that we're going to go on together and how we're going to generate that knowledge together. And this is almost a flow that a few of us put together in terms of thinking about how do we all agree a principle in which we do research together and all understand the expectations. Because as researchers, the last thing we want to do is overpromise and underdeliver. And I'm not saying that from look how much knowledge I've created, look how good my studies are, talking about look how little you can use this, because actually look how many more research questions it's come up with. So we need to go through this journey, this expectation when coaches can do it. And for those, probably the academics or the students in the room, you also don't need, this is being honest, you also don't need a coach who loves research. Because they don't have to love research to benefit from this. And in our experience, what we found is when we show a coach or a practitioner research that's been done, that's published with it, and you kind of get that look of, looks pretty academic to me, now show them a study like that in their place. They can't disagree that that's not theirs, or that's not their trends and what their players are showing. So actually involving people in this process of doing research is phenomenal for creating engagement and also for creating future research. So our principle and our philosophy of how we categorise our research questions are basically, are we trying to understand what, or are we trying to understand why? And we will never do the why until we understand the what. And this is where, from our experience, practitioners are excellent, because we designed studies before that are longitudinal in nature, and then Andy, for example, has come back and said, well, do you know that pathway is going to change in 2 years' time? So actually that work we invest in now isn't relevant. Okay, so we can change that, we can reevaluate what we're looking at. So if you use an example here of the what and the why, whenever we take research in practice or with a group of coaches, first thing is, what is going on? So example here, what are the physical characteristics of players? Now, you're going to get to our, you're going to, in that process, you're going to evaluate it scientifically, and you're going to find one of two things. The answer is either going to be as expected, or it's going to be different than expected. If the answer is as expected, brilliant, because it's a check of our practice, does it align with what the current thinking is. If it's different than expected, brilliant. We can then create publications, share that knowledge, because our view is that if one coach has that question, or one practitioner has that question, the chances are so many of the 10. So we should be sharing the work that we're doing, and we should also be sharing the knowledge to help progress the cycle. So once we've looked at what's going on, either is it something new or is it something we already knew, we then look at why it is. So going back to these characteristics, why are the characteristics developed in that way? Is it optimal? If we manipulate some load intensities, can we improve that? And then the next step there is, let's have a look in the literature to see if it's known. Because it may be, because there's a wealth of knowledge out there in terms of published studies that actually probably aren't utilised as well as they potentially could be. So if the answer is in the evidence base, and the answer is yes. We've gone through this cycle. A load of learning's taken place in practice, so it's been a great investment of time. If the answer of why they develop is no, again we can evaluate it scientifically. And we then come to, can we develop practice? In terms of the context stuff, so you look at the union, the limited amount of time you have under 18s. There's a lot of things we can't do because of context and playing structures. So the answer may be no. We still learn in practice. And if the answer is yes, we've developed practice and we've published. So this is where we can create a joint approach of actually developing research to have a genuine impact on developing practice. Now, we need this person in the middle, genuinely, because otherwise it can become disjointed and we may lose sight of what it is. And equally, we need to manage expectations from the start. And our philosophy has been, can we translate some of our language into the culture's language? So if we're looking at what's going on, we can use what this season. Let's do this study now and it can be used this season because it won't take very long, we'll get some really good insight, good snapshot to use. If you want to know why, that's the next season. So you need to be patient with us because it's not going to be a quick one. As soon as we start running these what's and these whys concurrently, and the coach also has within their development in terms of what information is going to feed back in, but even what information is going to feed back in later, you create then this philosophy of actually creating a great learning environment, a great thirst for knowledge in terms of how we can then use research in practice genuinely to improve what we're doing. And it avoids all the things around recording data, sharing data, because a competitive advantage doesn't come from the data. It comes from the innovation and creativity of producing that data. So the more data that we share, the more we understand that we don't know, and the more we then learn how to use other bits of data in practice. So it creates this fantastic opportunity to actually do some really progressive work. So hopefully, today you'll see that all the talks that are going to take place are taken from that person that sits in the middle camp, that takes from that person that has spent time understanding the context as well as the literature to then do a study. Now, what we would really value from the project point of view is understanding where this does or doesn't sit and where this does or doesn't fit with a coach's world or the academic world. Because the danger is as well that you try to satisfy too many people and you end up satisfying no one. So we need to make sure that actually our research philosophy is actually can be used in practice, and that's something that we'll talk about throughout the day. So you can see today in terms of the talks, you know, the match and training load, injury and concussion, psychology, some planning and periodization, and then some nutrition strength and conditioning. These snippets of work which can genuinely have an opportunity for to help practice and help you guys and coach in the room in terms of what you do next. And then in terms of again working, going back to the research process, again, what I'm not saying is that everyone should just do research and practice and it ends up where you don't have the controls that you want and so you're not confident in the outcomes. We need to do things properly. But I think if we work back through the research process, we can split things up into three categories. We can split this up into what we do as academics, as researchers, what we do, which is analyse data, collect information, make sense of those information. We can look at how we do it, which is design questions, recruit participants, etc. But where we can spend no time or very little time together is why we do it. And actually, what you generally tend to find is if we agree the why first, that the research and the practice have so much more synergies. And when you speak about why we do stuff, they do generally overlap, they're not the same between the research and the practice. So my why as an academic may have been, I want to improve my athletic performance. Andy's why may be, I want to optimise the development process of this group of athletes. Well, they're similar, but if we then align our whys to why we're doing it, it then makes sure that our how and our what are then in place. And we both know, again, the rules of engagement before we set on this journey. Because this journey, going back to the start, is expensive, takes a long time, and the last thing we want to do is come out with an outcome that creates a disappointment for both parties at the end. So if you almost look at a continuum of knowledge and application, the research sits at the knowledge end of the application, and the practice sits at the knowledge. The research sits at the knowledge side of the continuum. The research at the application side of the continuum. And this is the model that we've created in terms of the CARR project. And it's not within one, but it's now within a lot of clubs, and it's it allows people to understand these this season and next season questions. Because what we can't have, or what won't work, if you have one person in this model trying to do everything, it 100% won't work. Because people have unique skill sets. People have specific expertise. So if you look at the practice side of the continuum, we can evaluate how research helps practice, and that develops more research. But then again, on the research side of the practice, research side of the continuum, we offer new insights. And the example of that is that if Henry Ford asked people what they wanted, they said faster horses. So actually, it's not a case of just both doing the same thing. It's a case of appreciating what everybody can contribute to this wide model in terms of from the day-to-day working fast, person who can do a little bit of both, that research practitioner, and the slow person in terms of how they get to work. So I became a slow than a statistician straight away. The person who takes more time is a statistician than the chartered professional. They take longer to work, we know that because they have different challenges. If we can create a continuum, then it allows a great philosophy to develop work moving forward.
So again, just bring that into context very quickly, just from personal experiences, and I think very much around the two sides, we talk about working fast, working slowly. All the different roles and the different expertise and the different sort of models of staffing, it's very easy to set away and say, no, it's easy to just have my own staff and do what we need to do, from a coach's point of view. It's very easy to say, well, the stuff that you slow doesn't really matter to me now, so I don't want to invest in that. And equally, it's really easy to just get focused on the stuff that I can change tomorrow, so let's focus on. We do have that same caution, we will control the controllables. Some stuff we would like to change, we actually can't really control. But by having this ability to work fast and slow, to explore questions which can impact now and later, through personnel, through experience, we all in sport, in any sector, for a school teacher in primary school, teaching sport, if we're an academy coach working with 16 to 20 year olds, or if we're an international coach, we are fundamentally controlled by others who set the parameters within which we operate. And the working slow stuff really gives us the power and the knowledge to change things at a governance level. So the socio-political world that we still exist in as a coach, we still can appreciate. The things, if we go back a few slides and say, can we change that now? The answer might be no, but it might still be critically important. Because we'd like to change it, and with good knowledge and evidence, we might be able to change it in 2, 3, 4, 5 years.
So again, even on the practice side, on the left as you're looking at it, there's people in practice in every organisation, whether that's at the FA, whether it's at the RFD, whether it's in clubs, where they have to look at the governance and the regulations of the game, and research is important to them. And as such, it's important for us coaches because that's what changes that sandy road that our car's operating on, the way in which we can apply knowledge and understanding. So I think it's just really a big push for me. I think myself as lucky as being exposed to these different journeys that we've done to create something. Some of it helps us as coaches operate much, much better next week than this week when we start to work with research practitioners. Coaches and practitioners and researchers around each other on a day-to-day basis. Some of the things that actually helps us with are the more monthly sit-downs at management level, which is usually where things are either working slow. My brain works slow quite a lot,
certainly half of it does.
And some of that is where you have to accept that not everything can be impacted tomorrow. But stuff you need to, even as a coach in an academy, as a school teacher, looking at the way in which you manage your students in the game, we do need to influence something a lot, and some of the evidence is critically important at those levels as well. So I think, again, the model and the benefits of it are really wide-reaching, and we can only cover so many of them up at the front but I'm sure you guys are saying any questions on how this model works or doesn't work for us hasn't been in the past. It'd be very easy for us to pick up an email and put it on the chat to you, because it's something which has gone great value over the last 3 or 4 years, and I'm sure it'll continue to do so.
So just to finish off, all the talks today, we hope, come from the middle ground. We genuinely hope that it has applications for everybody, and again, we value feedback from that. And last thing, thank you for listening, and the work that is going to be shared today isn't from the speaker, it's led by the speaker, whoever that is. We have a massive research team here who do some phenomenal work and work really hard to genuinely do work to help practice and do it passionately. So a big thank you to all the guys involved with the research project.